You know, this was supposed to be a simple video, you know, just like an average, normal video where I talk about wrestling and some of my favorite moments in wrestling history, but then it all gets ruined with one tweet. Oh, one tweet. That's all it took. It was specifically this tweet from Gremlin to Twilight Palms, aka Angie. They're a lovely artist. They do badass work. Go follow them. That's besides the point. The point is this. What Gremlin proposes is that because in the most recent episode of Marvel's Secret Wars, they reference The Undertaker, WWE is now canon in the MCU. And if WWE is canon in the MCU, that would mean AEW is canon in the MCU. But here's the thing about that. AEW started in 2019. Its first ever pay-per-view, Double or Nothing, was May 25th, 2019. Nearly a year to the day after this happens. Half of all existence erased from the face of the map in an event in the MCU referred to as the Blip, where the mad Titan Thanos eradicates half of all living creatures in a desperate bid to bring balance to the universe, but instead only brings sorrow and loneliness everywhere he goes. Which, I will argue, is probably not the best time to try to start a wrestling company. I am, however, kind of willing to give AEW the benefit of the doubt on this one. I mean, arguably another bad time to try to start a wrestling company would be during a global pandemic and a national lockdown, but still, AEW persisted and somehow thrived despite all of the whole COVID-19-ness of 2020. Now, I'm not saying COVID-19 is anything like having half of all living creatures eradicated from the face of the planet, but it's close enough that I could say that in the face of peril, AEW's willing to persist. Not to mention, before the snap even happens, wheels were already in motion for what would eventually become All Elite Wrestling, thanks to Cody Rhodes and All In. The precursor to AEW's existence, All In, was the largest independent wrestling event ever, selling well over 10,000 tickets in Cody Rhodes' grandiose attempt to say, "Fuck you, Dave Meltzer." And it wasn't just a great one-off story either. It proved to be the launching ground for AEW, All Elite Wrestling, the biggest competitor to the WWE in nearly 20 years. The only problem is that All In happened September 1st, 2018, 3 months after the events of the snap. So with 50% of the roster completely disappeared, who are we left with? Well, to figure that out, I went to didthanoskill.me, a website that will tell you if the Mad Titan decided to spare your life or sacrifice you for the greater good. And alongside that, I made an entirely too large spreadsheet where I listed everyone involved with All In, everyone involved with Double or Nothing, basically all of the big names in the first year of AEW, from All In all the way to the first episode of Dynamite. And I asked Thanos if they were spared or if they were sacrificed. And I guess Thanos is a massive fan of AEW for some reason, because actually 60% of our roster survived, a 10% increase over the whole half of the universe thing. The only problem is when it comes to the big names. I will say, luckily, Tony and Shahid Khan were both spared by Thanos. They probably paid him off, let's be honest. So that means we do at least have the bankroll to produce the first year of AEW television. But Cody and Brandi Rhodes, The Young Bucks, MJF, Orange Cassidy, Britt Baker, Kazuchika Okada, and most importantly, the biggest signing for AEW's first year, Chris Jericho, were all taken out by the snap, leaving only Kenny Omega, Hangman Page, and Kota Ibushi as our big selling points for All In. We also do luckily get to keep one of the big marquee matches, as both Christopher Daniels and Stephen Amell survived the snap. The only difference is that Daniels comes to the ring with Scorpio Sky, as Kazarian was unfortunately snapped away as well. But otherwise, that match remains pretty much the same. As for Hangman Page and Joey Janela, their match is now turned into a number one contenders bout, with the winner going on to take Cody's place against Nick Aldis for the NWA Championship later on in the show. The biggest match affected has to be the main event, which originally saw Fénix, Bandido, and Rey Mysterio taking on the team of the Young Bucks and Kota Ibushi. But now, with Bandido and the Bucks erased off the face of the planet, we've got to make some changes. And, well, given that one of the other marquee matches from the original All In was Kenny Omega versus Pentagon Jr., it only makes sense to really smush those two matches together to give the crowd a main event of the Lucha Brothers, Pentagon and Fénix, taking on the Golden Lovers, Kenny Omega and Kota Ibushi. So, I guess All In wasn't completely ruined by the blip. I mean, on any other day, even in this universe, Lucha Bros versus Golden Lovers, Hangman Page versus Nick Aldis, Mel and Christopher Daniels, that's still a pretty damn good card. And honestly, with the Bucks and Cody disappearing, three of his best friends, I think that would only strengthen Kenny Omega's resolve to do something great with their legacies, to build something better than themselves, to create a company where not just one match is going to give you elite level performances, but instead to give a company that has all elite wrestling. See how it works? Now it's like an emotional tie-in to the story. I don't know. Anyways, that brings us to our first press conference of AEW, which looks a whole lot different than it did in real life, this time with the Young Bucks and Cody Rhodes as massive banners overlooking the beginning of a company that they helped inspire. The show begins with Hangman Page coming out and essentially hyping up the crowd for the birth of AEW. He's now taking on a bigger role in the company, more similar to what Cody and the Young Bucks had in real life. And then after that, he mentions that at All In, he got to taste gold when he faced off against Nick Aldis, but he came up just that little bit short. But he intends to taste gold again, as before the end of the year, he will be the first ever All Elite Wrestling Champion. At which point, Pac comes out, interrupts him, there's a whole argument. It's essentially the same segment that there was in real life between these two. Then, throughout the rest of the show, they announce the signings of various individuals like SCU and the Lucha Bros to the tag division. We get Mercedes Martinez and Awesome Kong for the women's division, and we start to set up a few matches for Double or Nothing along the way, before we get to the main event of the evening, where of course Kenny Omega comes up and stares at those banners of the Young Bucks and Cody Rhodes, and he pontificates on the importance of elite-level wrestling, on the importance of what they do in the professional wrestling ring. He talks about how the Young Bucks and Cody, more than anything else, wanted to change the face of professional wrestling. They wanted to change the world, and that there was one man who Kenny knew shared those ideals. And he was the first man that he called when he was going to start AEW because he knew he'd come. And that man is Kota Ibushi. Ibushi walks out onto the stage, shakes hands with Kenny, and the duo embrace as the Golden Lovers reunite to close out the first ever AEW press conference. This is kind of where I'm a little bit nervous for All Elite Wrestling, unfortunately, in the MCU, because the biggest boon for them starting things off was the signing of Chris Jericho. Jericho coming out on the stage at the end of the press conference was the moment that a lot of people collectively went, oh shit, they're serious. And while, yes, I love Ibushi and I love Kenny Omega, I don't know if the Golden Lovers reuniting is going to be big enough to really get an American audience interested in this brand new startup company. Which is why I want to add one more thing in the build up to Double or Nothing. I mean, yes, we're going to have more press conferences, ticket parties, and all of the various independent wrestling appearances, but I want there to be one last press conference at the beginning of May just to promote Double or Nothing. Essentially, I want something kind of similar to UFC press conferences, where just like all of the competitors come out on the stage, they answer questions from the press, they trash talk, they promote matches, they do a little bit of storytelling, but really the important thing here is that it's going to announce the main event of Double or Nothing. And it is going to be, much like in real life, a one-on-one bout, with the winner going on to face the winner of the Casino Battle Royal to determine the first ever AEW World Champion. And Justin Roberts, who luckily didn't get snapped, we lost a lot of good people on that side of the table. We lost Excalibur, and that made me really upset, but Justin Roberts is there, and he announces that in this main event, your first combatant will be the best bout machine, Kenny Omega. And across from him will be none other than Jon Moxley. And there has been no promotion of Moxley up to this point. There are no, like, escaping the prison videos. There's no teases. There's no... No one knows where he's at after he left WWE. People are still thinking Dean Ambrose is going to return to the company. But instead, he makes his appearance here. And at the exact same moment, the chat room that is watching along to this press conference will all collectively go, oh shit, they're serious. And look, I know this is nowhere near as good as what we had in real life, but I'm kind of working with a limited roster here. We have to get as many eyes on Double or Nothing as possible, and in real life, they used Jericho to do that. Here, we're gonna use Moxley. Cut to Double or Nothing, and we see Kota Ibushi winning the Casino Battle Royal after a prolonged Final Two battle with Hangman Page. I mean, if you've seen those two at Supercard of Honor, you know those two can put on an absolute banger of a match. So yeah, that's how I end that. I also am going to, since we don't have Sean Spears, he got snapped away, I'm going to instead introduce none other than Eli Drake. Yeah, because it's a crime no one was doing anything with him back then. I think he should have been snapped up by AEW, but they didn't, and it's a crime no one did anything with him back then, and it's a crime they're still not really doing anything with him right now, but yeah, they need to bring Eli Drake in, and that's where we're going to do it. We also see a special Joshi match with Shida and Riho overcoming the team of Emi Sakura and Yuka Sakazaki, with that match only having to change a little bit. I can't remember who got snapped away. One of the other people got snapped away, so we had to change things up just a little bit. We also see SCU being defeated by the Lucha Bros and Mercedes Martinez managing to overcome the might of Awesome Kong. And then in our main event, Kenny Omega faces off against Jon Moxley in a brutal, bloody, beatdown battle. Ooh, that was some fun alliteration. That ends with Kenny Omega reversing an attempt at the paradigm shift to get him up on his shoulders and drop him with the one winged angel. 1, 2, 3. And look, I know on paper, the safe choice really is to hotshot Jon Moxley to the title, kind of similar to what they did with Chris Jericho in real life, but I'm not gonna pass up an opportunity to have the Golden Lovers fighting each other. That's just not the type of person I am. Not to mention, this whole story up to this point has been about Kenny Omega. It's been about a guy fighting for his lost friends, about creating a legacy that they weren't able to, about a guy who was looking to prove that their type of wrestling, that their type of characters, their personalities belong on that main event scene like a Jon Moxley does, like a Chris Jericho does. And it just doesn't make sense to me to not have that guy fighting in the main event for your championship in the first ever show. So fast forward to the first ever All Out, live from Chicago, Illinois, and here's where a lot of things have to change pretty quickly. The only match I actually didn't have to change was Riho versus Shida. And I still changed it because I'm a little stinker, I guess. Instead of it being to determine who's going to go on to fight for the title, it's now just for the championship. We are going to crown the inaugural AEW Women's Champion at All Out, and much like in real life, it is going to be Riho who earns that title. In addition, Hangman Page, now completely out of the title picture, goes on to have a rematch against Joey Janela from last year's All In. That was basically the match of All In, and this year they get to run it back, except this time, Janela takes the victory after Pac returns and takes out Hanger on the outside. In addition, Lucha Bros basically make themselves the tag team of the AEW tag team division when they defeat the newly signed Private Party in a high-flying, spectacular bout. And in the main event, Kota Ibushi and Kenny Omega put on a 5-star classic against one another, both men throwing everything they have at each other in a desperate bid to call themselves the first ever AEW World Champion. But despite all of his passion and despite everything in his heart, Kota Ibushi eventually falls to an avalanche one-winged angel from Omega, who pins him 1, 2, 3. And the match ends with Kenny staring down at the belt, tears in his eyes before embracing Ibushi, and then he climbs up to the top rope, and he holds that belt to the heavens, holding it up almost as a tribute to Cody, Matt, and Nick. And he stares down at that belt when suddenly static fills the arena and the lights go black. And at this point, the entire arena fucking explodes, baby, because like I said, we are in Chicago, Illinois, and CM Punk is returning to professional wrestling for the first time in years to stand face to face with the best bout machine, Kenny Omega. A moment that would even have Vince McMahon at home staring at the screen and saying, "Oh shit, they're serious." Now, look, I'm not hot-shotting CM Punk into a title feud or anything like that. It's just that I needed another big name, and everyone else was signed to WWE at the time. I couldn't just randomly be like, and then it goes, wampadoo, and then John Cena shows up. Like, I still had to somewhat follow the rules of the universe, and in this universe, CM Punk is still available as a free agent, so I'm gonna bring him in and have him immediately go face-to-face with Kenny Omega. But things change a little bit when we move on to Dynamite, the first ever episode of Dynamite, which opens with that exact same promo from CM Punk from the first dance in 2021. The only difference is this time, instead of ending it by challenging Darby Allin, he issues an open challenge to the entire locker room, an open challenge that is answered by Sammy Guevara. I mean, Punk made it pretty clear that he was there to help young talent starting off, and given that Darby Allin got snapped away, the next obvious choice for me is Sammy Guevara. Have Punk take the role Cody Rhodes had on the first ever episode of Dynamite, and have both of those guys put on a classic match. Not to mention, Sammy does the GTH, Punk does the GTS. It works there as well. So yeah, we've got that going on. In addition, we get to see a tag team tournament begin, much like the one in real life, to determine the first ever tag champions. And in the quarterfinals, there is a massive upset as SCU get taken out by Private Party. Later in the show, Hangman Page angrily attempts to call out Pac, but instead gets interrupted by Eli Drake. Yeah, who comes out to the ring, heels on Hangman, and eventually eats a Deadeye, which sets up a match between the two for next week. So Eli gets to be like the minor villain, with Pac being the big bad of Hanger's first feud. We also get to see the new women's champion Riho taking on Emi Sakura with her title on the line, and then in the main event, in another quarterfinal match for the AEW Tag Team Championships, we see the Lucha Bros versus the Golden Lovers. And in that matchup, it's very similar to the first ever Dynamite main event, with Moxley returning, assaulting Kenny, and both of them brawling all around the arena. The only difference is this time, John's not just craving blood, he's craving gold. And that's our first feud for the AEW World Championship, Jon Moxley versus Kenny Omega. Meanwhile, Kota Ibushi desperately tries to win the match for his team, puts everything he has into it, but eventually falls to a fear factor, and the Lucha Bros get the victory and move on in the tournament. But as they celebrate that victory, they're suddenly attacked by men in rubber masks, not unlike what happened to the Young Bucks at the actual All Out 2019. The only difference is who's underneath those masks, as instead of it being Santana and Ortiz like it was in real life, it's now Ortiz, no Santana unfortunately, Homicide, Conan, and Eddie Kingston. LAX debut in the main event of the first ever Dynamite and immediately take out the men who will, spoiler alert, become the first ever AEW Tag Team Champions. And instead of the Inner Circle being formed, we have a more established tag team taking their spot. Because, in my opinion, I think that's the safer option, and the company has already tried to take enough risks. I mean, trying to start a company when half of reality's been erased is already a big enough risk, so we can play it safe. But to be honest with you, I think AEW still could survive. I mean, AEW was already kind of working behind the proverbial eight ball in real life. I mean, they had a billion-dollar corporation, WWE, trying to counter-program them with NXT, a show that arguably was kind of their AEW, with a lot of great independent talent like Kyle O'Reilly and Adam Cole, Keith Lee appearing every single week. And honestly, if it wasn't for the signings of Chris Jericho and Jon Moxley, I don't know if the company could have gotten off the ground in real life, let alone in a world where half of their roster had been snapped away by evil Grimace. So, I don't know, I think they could have thrived. I think AEW does their best work when they're being told to sink or swim. I mean, that's kind of the impetus of All In from the very beginning, was Dave Meltzer saying, "You can't do this," and Cody Rhodes saying, "Yes, I can." So, I think it wasn't impossible. I think that even with half of reality being snapped out of existence, we could still have some AEW. But that's enough rambling from me. What do you guys think personally? Do you agree? Do you disagree? Do you think that AEW could survive if Grimace snapped away half of existence? That's not a question I expected to be asking this morning. Actually, you know what? Answer the more important question down in the comments. If AEW was in the MCU, who would win in a fight? Loki or Orange Cassidy? I mean, I'm personally pulling for OC myself, but I don't know. Let me know in the comments below, what do you guys think? And in the meantime, in between time, make sure to subscribe. That way you get some Fight Boys in your feed every single week. We do gaming videos on Monday and Fridays in WWE games, AEW games. They're all there for you guys to check out. And then, of course, every Wednesday, we do stupid little videos like this. So make sure to subscribe to get that in your feed. Follow us on Twitter at Fight Boys Show. Do whatever you like. I don't know. Live your life, have fun, enjoy the fact that 100% of existence is here right now, and always remember that when you're a fight boy, you're a fight boy for life!